Mateus is typically known as a very quick starter. He likes to come out of the gate and throw heavy shots.
Mateus in the white. Eddie Kalai in the green and black. Trying to cut off the cage early on is Eddie Kalai. Look for him to get on the inside of Mateus and throw that heavy lever. Opens up with a jab there as Eddie Kalai. Big cracking outside thigh kick from Mateus. Both men swinging wildly in the opening 40 seconds here. Inside thigh kick from Mateus. Certainly, Mitch, not much of a filling out process here. Left hook there from Kalai.
Kalai came in connected nicely. He's got a nice, big, straight right hand. Now Mateus goes for the clinch, ties him up. Easily gets turned over, but reverses it quite nicely. Now he's on top. This is not a position Mateus is used to being in. Kalai presses him back up against the cage.
What can Kalai do from top position? Wants to work some ground and pound. Mateus back to his feet. Mateus trying to put Eddie Kalai on his back now. What a start to our prelim show here in Manila. Ultra aggression from both these athletes in the opening round. Beautiful knee to the ribs there from Mateus. Wherever you're watching live on Facebook, hope you're enjoying it. We're also live on Twitter at One Championship. Guillotine attempt here from Mateus.
You can see Mateus trying to adjust there. Kalai was able to take him down past the guard and now is in side control. Mateus is not giving that head up though. He's got to be careful because there is a choke from this angle, but most likely Kalai is not that comfortable throwing that up right yet.
Eddie Kalai back to his feet, threw a short knee to the nose on his way back up there. Eddie Kalai, the Malaysian. Mateus, the Indonesian. Posting up in that right arm is Eddie Kalai. He's inside control now. Where can he go from here, Mitch?
Now he's trying to step over the head, possibly looking for an arm. The way that Mateus has that arm trap, throw it over, go for it. But now he's thinking of a rear naked choke. Doesn't quite have the back, though.
Takes the back of Mateus. Can he sink a rear naked about halfway through the opening round? Powers down with an elbow. Full mount now for Eddie Kalai. High mount for him. Ground and pound chance. Mateus gives his back in. Kalai just slid down there, unfortunately for him, Mitch. But still in mount position.
He's given up some bad positions, but he's scrambling. He's consistently trying to move out of these bad positions into worse positions. But now he's on top. It's a very fast and furious first round. You got Mateus on top, dropping a little bit of elbows to soften Kalai up. These guys are going pretty hard. You gotta wonder if this gets to the second round, who's gonna have the better conditioning?
Close guard here from Eddie Kalai. Under 1 minute remaining, first round. It's really been a seesawing contest. Kalai glancing towards his corner for some instruction. What does the boxer do here, Mitch, off his back?
He's got to try to get up. He doesn't really have much of an active guard game. He's not really throwing any submissions. All he's doing is putting his foot on the hips. But as I say that, he looks like he's threatening a triangle choke here. He gave it up, though. He had a possible rubber guard there where he reached up and grabbed his own foot. But Mateus was able to slide out.
Mateus slings the legs a little here. Will he invite Eddie Kalai back to his feet? And referee Kim Ching does it for him. So a chance now for Eddie Kalai to get those hands off. And a chance for Mateus to get the leg kicks as he was earlier on in the bout. One way to slow down a boxer's punching is to take out their legs. Mateus has the back here. Can he put the hooks in? One's in. Can he get the second hook in?
It's a bit high.
Going to try and flatten him out here. Try and work a choke with 50 seconds remaining.
It's underneath the chin. That could
Adrian
be it.
Mateus.
It's deep.
That's good night, Irene! Adrian Mateus taps out Eddie Kalai. What a way to start Global Superheroes!
Beautifully done. He had the back a few times in that round, but he was finally able to settle down, gain his composure. Once he secured the position, then enabled him to go after the submission. Slid the first hand in, locked up the choke, and closed the night out. Beautifully done. Watch this. First, he establishes position. Very well done. He's fighting the hands. Slides one hand right up under the neck. That's it. I should have been defending the other hand. He should have been defending the left hand, but he was defending the choking arm. That's where the defense had to come from. And he tapped out to send himself back home. But beautifully done by the Indonesian Adrian Mateus.
Fantastic first round win for Adrian Mateus. Ooh. Can he finally get that win on the board? Let's see how the yoga and the meditation over the last 4 weeks pays off for Rajinder Singh Mina.
Typically, we see Rajinder Singh Mina only moving back and forth. I'd like to see him utilize some lateral movement, moving left and moving right, always moving his head.
Two very large, well-built lightweights. And oh, Rajinder Singh Mina gets a knockdown. The ground and pound, he'll try and sink a choke. A house on fire, the Indian. Find the finish here. This would be a huge upset. Zhang Zhihao stuck in his attempted guillotine at the moment. He's finally done it. Rajinder Singh Mina has rendered Zhang Zhihao momentarily out of it to take the victory in the sweetest of fashions. My word, Mitch. Certainly the yoga and meditation paid off.
That's all he needed was to get his mind right. He has all the skills to reach the very top, and he did it tonight. What a tremendous punch landed. As Zhang Jia was coming in, he caught him. Decided not to go for the ground and pound. Saw the guillotine open, jumped on the choke.
We have never seen Rajinder Singh Mina with this sort of self-confidence, and it paid huge dividends.
Tremendous. Look at that. Caught him with a big right hand. Didn't choose the ground and pound. Chose to adjust the guillotine. Look at him. Consistently moving. There it is. Bingo. Right on the button. Ket Jong coming in. Puts him down. Jumps all over him. Big submission win for Rajinder Singh Mina.
This one should be interesting. Hope you're enjoying all the action live on Facebook, live on Twitter. If you're not following us, make sure you do. At One Championship. Inside leg kicks early. Osenio said she worked the kicks in training for this one. Said that Torres's kick defense is not apparent. Looking for a choke early here is April Osenio.
There's a guillotine nice and tight, but it looks like she's going to pop her head out as she does. I like how Osenio was setting up those low kicks. She threw three inside low kicks and then followed up, faked the third one, and threw a big right hand. Armbar.
Armbar coming from April Osenio. Oh, and Torres.
Oh!
The GoDaddy knockout of the night.
Man, I don't know. GoDaddy's gotta give it to Jomary. Look at this. April throws up the armbar, one of her favorite submissions. Jomary Torres clasps the hands, sends her up, and takes her for the ride.
Can you believe that? Not even a year ago, even 8 months ago, nobody knew the name Jomary Torres. And look what she's doing to opponents now. Will we see a GoDaddy knockout of the night here between Meas Meul and Edward Kelly? Inside leg early from Meas Meul. Quinn Kamai and judo stylist. If Kelly knocks out the Cambodian, this place will go bananas. Oh, there's the left.
Oh!
Edward Kelly throws the one, the two, finishes it with a beautiful high kick.
Amazing scenes inside the massive ball of Asia Arena here in Manila. I told you they'd go bananas if you knocked out Meas Meul. I never thought it would happen that quickly.
he just starched him. Those high kicks are a thing of beauty. And when he lets them go, when he has confidence and believes in himself, that is what Edward Kelly is capable of. Is that the GoDaddy knockout of the night? Beautifully done. Look at this. Look at this combination. Sees it, goes two, throws the hook. Boom, and just catches it. That was a high knee that caught him on the chin.
Here we go, first round of action. Big height advantage going the way of Pucci. Can he use his reach here?
These are the low kicks. That's what Urrutia said he wants to do. He wants to go after the lead leg of Bruno Pucci to eliminate that. Oh, he tested the chin right there. Caught him with a straight right.
Urrutia said there'll be no feeling out process. And already aiming towards that jawline of Bruno Pucci. Pucci's got to use that long, sticky jab of his Mitch.
Yeah, we gave Bruno Pucci the grappling advantage, but the striking is going to get really intriguing between these two. Who can get off first? Who can utilize that head movement and throw out those punches?
Beautiful tagging left hand there from Urrutia on the front foot. And Pucci circles into the right hand. Doesn't want to be going that way. That's the power hand of the Honey Badger. High right roundhouse from the Brazilian.
Bruno, he's coming in, he's getting tagged by Urrutia. He's got to move that head, utilize some lateral movement. Urrutia's catching him in some wild exchanges here.
They clinch up for the first time. Urrutia's left hand's been doing damage in the striking so far. He's got an overhook on the right arm of Pucci. He looks for a takedown. What a start!
You can see Urrutia just shrugging him off with that whizzer on that left side. He's pushing him away, creating a little bit of space. This first clinch is going to tell us a lot about the grappling capability. Is Bruno Pucci able to control it? But Urrutia was able to throw him off. Look for that big right hand to come again, Michael.
Will it go back to the left to set up that big thumping right hand? Pucci's got to start to get his jab off. And he threads a nice hook there. Does the Brazilian. Urrutia backs him up. There's the left, the old 1-2. Beautiful smack bang to the kisser with the right hand. And Pucci does a quick count of his teeth.
I'd like to see Urrutia go back to that low kick. That was working for him. He's getting a little bit anxious going after the head. But Pucci, because he landed those early strikes.
There was the jab from Pucci. Goes a roundhouse kick, lead leg, no switch up to the rib cage. Threads the jab again, does Pucci. A little more flat footed of the two here is Bruno Pucci. Jab two from Urrutia, backs up the Brazilian.
Urrutia's leaving his head up when he's coming in though, so Bruno's able to counter punch him. As long as he keeps moving back, keeps that head movement.
Shoots in for a takedown, nice evasion there from Emilio Urrutia. Do you think Pucci is feeling that pressure of Urrutia constantly coming forward on him here, Mitch?
You know, Bruno Pucci's been the victim of two big knockouts. He's got to be very careful. He might be a little gun-shy when it comes to rushing in. When he sees Urrutia starting to pressure him, he kind of fades back a little bit. He's got to be careful. There's another one. Big right hand that connected.
Left hook, right hand, two-punch combination. Oh, right hand!
The chin's holding up. Pucci's got to do something. He's got to move.
He's in all sorts of bother. Bruno Pucci may be ripe for the picking.
Look how patient Urrutia is. He's not pulling the trigger too soon. He's calculating. Oh, Bruno Pucci's on rubber legs right now.
Bruno Pucci taking more knocks than a front door here in the first round. And Urrutia sizes him up, drills another right hand to the jaw. You can see the rubber legs, the challenge legs now on Bruno Pucci.
Pucci's getting lit up. He's got to create some movement. Going for the takedown. Oh, he's out!
Kibosh! It's good night, Irene! Emilio! And is that the GoDaddy knockout of the night?
This card has been filled with some amazing contenders for that GoDaddy knockout of the night. We've still got Brandon Vera here. He's waiting to come in on round two so he can deliver his scorecard. But the action, the shots just keep coming.
Brandon Vera, heavyweight champion of the world. I will ask you, what mistakes did Pucci make?
Pucci made the biggest mistake of not moving and exchanging with this guy. The first time he got tagged two or three times, he should have started working against the cage, closing the space, and make sure you got him to the ground. Biggest problem, standing with this monster. Look at that.
Ready, go!
Hayato Suzuki in the white and red. Yago Bryan in the black. Look for the hands here of Iago Bryan. Look for Suzuki to try and get the Brazilian down, take his back and choke him out. And there, the takedown early from Suzuki. He'll try and pass guard here, go to side control.
He wasted no time getting that takedown. He did not want to test the stand-up of Iago Bryan. But we get to see the ground game, something we're not used to. Look at the way he has the hand trapped of Iago Bryan. He has reached under and clasped the arm. So the left arm of Iago Bryan is completely immobilized, and it opens up strikes to the left side of his head.
Suzuki trying to go to half guard on the left side of the body here of Iago Bryan. We do talk so highly about Bryan's boxing skills, but he is a BJJ black belt, BJJ champion. And we're getting to see a taste of that off the back here of the Brazilian.
Suzuki's trying to step over the half guard here, but he's got one guard cleared, one leg cleared. It's kind of like the first step in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. You want to clear the legs of your opponent, then establish dominant control. But he's got that dominant control. He let go of the hand, so now Iago Bryan can defend the left side. And look at that. Suzuki's attacking the right side now.
Hayato Suzuki inside half guard. Still looking to pass and go to the left side of Iago Bryan's body. 1.5 minutes down here in the opening round.
He's almost fully past the half guard now. You can see that left leg of Suzuki's going to try to slice through, put his knee on the back, and slide that leg through. But Iago Bryan's holding on to that leg with his legs. He's almost out. He's pushing. That hand is the only thing stopping him. And he's almost through. Oh, he's giving up his back. But Iago Bryan does a good job of getting back in the guard.
You cannot afford for a millisecond to give your back to Hayato Suzuki. That's where Suzuki wants to be. On the back, sinking in the hooks and slapping on a rear naked choke. But now, Bryan puts him back inside the full guard and closes the guard.
Suzuki's not really attempting to do any damage with the ground and pound. He's trying to establish dominant position. Look at him trying to thread that hand behind Iago Bryan's back. So he's trying to situate himself into a more dominant position without having to. Here he goes, trying to pass that guard now. Ooh, and he passed the guard and he crucifixed the arm.
For the first time in this match, we see Suzuki take side control. Now he's going to take the back. This is trouble. This is danger. This is Suzuki land. Wrist control. Nice back elbow there from Iago Bryan. Beautiful time in again. That's one way to try and shuck him off. But you see Suzuki now will try and get those hooks in. He'll try and flatten out Iago Bryan. This is dangerous for Bryan.
Suzuki wasn't fazed by the elbows. He was hunting for that back position. Got the two hooks in. Now he's got full back control. Iago's trying to defend one hook. He did that, but you can just see him. Suzuki stomping with the heel, attacking the legs, attacking the body.
Just under 2 minutes remaining in the first round. Not a position Bryan wants to be in. This is where Suzuki begins to work his magic, and you know he can conjure a rear naked choke from virtually anywhere.
This is what he's hunting for. He's always threatening to attack these hands. He's always trying to get that proper position so he can start threading the arm underneath the neck. Iago Bryan is doing a good job of defending up, but Suzuki landed on the ground. He got it to the end, but Iago Bryan's turning. He's trying to fight that hook, but he's not defending the choke.
Bryan trying to see out the opening round. Still 70 seconds of it remaining.
Find out. That's bad. That's a bad spot to be in. Oh, he's going to try to squeeze.
Here it comes from Hayato Suzuki. Flips him out like a Japanese pancake. And it's good night, Irene. Hayato Suzuki back in the winner's circle. And as he predicted, first round, rear naked choke.
The first round finishes. Just keep coming in Manila, making Brandon Vera's job really easy tonight as Hayato Suzuki celebrates high above the cage.
Brandon Vera, I'll ask you here, what mistakes did Iago Bryan make in this match?
Iago Bryan was so excited about getting his strikes off that he didn't defend the very first takedown. Once he was on his back, on his knees, it was all Hayato. The control was amazing, and he was doing damage with strikes while hunting for the neck the whole time. This guy is amazing. I'm really excited to watch him fight again.
And Vietnam Bulgarian Satir Kichikov. Southpaw stance early here from Mahalbin, the Southern Eagle. Says he wants to stand and trade with the Bulgarian and knock him out. Kichikov says he is not impressed by Mahalbin's wrestling.
Kichikov's coming out and throwing some wide strikes, really wailing on these hooks. That kind of opens up the takedown for Mahalbin. He likes to slide under these punches and go for that double leg.
Using plenty of movement around the cage here early on, the Southern Eagle, Mahalbin tracks a roundhouse kick to the right ribs of Kichikov. Right high kick going for the headache maker. Up on the balls of his feet as the young Southern Eagle from China goes the body, then goes the sternum, misses with both.
He's kind of telegraphing these body shots. He's lunging into his strikes.
While Mahalbin says he wants to stand and trade with Kichikov, you've got to wonder what will happen. Should Kichikov catch the Southern Eagle in the jaw? And then Mahalbin says, nope, no more. And he takes him down, puts him on his back.
Kichikov's got a very active ground game. He's got a good guard. He likes to put his foot on his hips and threaten a lot of submissions. He also likes to drop those elbows as well.
First fake of a takedown attempt there from Mahalbin. Lots of movement from the Chinese martial artist. Threads the overhand left. That being the power hand of the southpaw.
Let's see Mahalbin at least threaten the takedown. You know, tap the legs occasionally, change levels, get Kichikov thinking about the takedown so he doesn't relax too much in the striking.
Mahalbin has used a lot of range so far. He has not stood in the pocket here with Kichikov and traded blows. It's been all long-reaching technique from the Chinese. Kichikov. It's out of the way of that powerful overhand left again. The Bulgarian circles off clockwise, which is where he wants to go against the southpaw. Low single-leg attempt there from Mahalbin. Sakuraba style to no avail.
Came a little bit, he kind of let the sign go that he was coming in on. He reached for that leg. Kichikov was able to slide that front leg out of the way and defend the takedown quite nicely.
Halfway through the opening round, turning left hook there from Kichikov. Didn't turn the knuckles in, however, caught him with the inside of the glove.
But he's not staying in the pocket. You can immediately see he throws a quick exchange and he gets out of there. He knows that Mahalbin wants to clinch up and drag this to the mat, but Kichikov's showing good footwork.
The man has really got the reach down as of yet, with 2:10 remaining in the first round. Takedown attempt here from Mahalbin. Going against what he said he would do, and now we're on the ground for the first time.
And I like how he did that, Michael. He faked the overhand, then attacked the single leg. I was about to say good defense from Kichikov, but Mahalbin kept that single nice and tight and went after a trip. Kichikov pops back up, though. Good job.
Solid job from Kichikov. Mahalbin tried to tag him the way up. The Bulgarian a little too elusive. Switching stance momentarily here, Mahalbin to orthodox. His preferred stance is southpaw. He is a lefty.
It's got to build the confidence of Kichikov to be able to shrug off a takedown like that, and to be able to pop back up without really a lot of resistance.
Kichikov circling. Now he's circling counterclockwise. Even though Mahalbin is in orthodox stance, left hand is still the power hand. Got to be careful which way you go. Left hook and a single leg takedown attempt from Mahalbin. It was quick. Gets a takedown. Kichikov with his back down. Side control for the Chinese.
That was nice. That single leg. He was able to turn the corner exceptionally fast and get Kichikov down. You can see Kichikov's trying to walk off the wall, trying to change the position. Maybe to get use his feet to kind of push away a little bit. Mahalbin's aggressive on top.
And the fist strikes from Mahalbin. He tries to take the back of the Bulgarian. And he tries and sink a choke from this position. Mahalbin doesn't have it. Threads a knee. Kichikov trying to move him on. Back onto the back goes Mahalbin. High knee again. Kichikov sprawls out. Evades a single leg. Resets it as Mahalbin gets the takedown. Kichikov hoping for a choke here.
He was close to it. That was pretty good for Kichikov to get back up. But the takedowns are starting to add up. And as we finally get to come check out the heavyweight champion scorecard, how is he going to add all these up?
We are going to go to the second round for the first time tonight. We saw Mahalbin switch starts towards the end of the first round from southpaw to orthodox. He'll open up in his preferred southpaw stance, which means Kitchikov wants to get that lead foot on the outside of Mahalbin's lead foot. But immediately, interestingly here, Mitch, he switches to orthodox Mahalbin. Why the switching?
I think he heard you. I think he didn't want you to tell his secret plan, and he changed his stance. But that's changing of the stances confuses your opponent. It's really hard to get a gauge on their distance and really what it's coming out of if they're consistently switching stances. And Mahalbin is changing it up.
So now Kitchikov is presented with a predicament. Do you drift into the rear hand of Mahalbin, being the right hand of the guy who is a left-handed athlete?
In this instance, you would still want to circle away from the power. There's a reason why Mahalbin is changing his stances, and he's actually preferring to stay in this this right-hand stance. He might slowly start to shift back to his southpaw stance, but Kitchikov is going to want to circle to his right to alleviate that power hand.
Left hook there from Mahalbin. On the front foot, the Chinese athlete. Kitchikov backs it up with that right hand, shoots in for a double leg. Good sprawl out from the Bulgarian. Defensive takedown attempt. Is he going to choke going here, Mitch?
Good sprawl, but he's kind of on the wrong side of the choke. I don't know if he's got the hand a little bit high on the body. I think he's just kind of controlling the head to be able to push off and get back up, and that's exactly what he does.
Kitchikov just adjusting his trunks. Mahalbin still in this orthodox stance. Fakes a roundhouse kick off the back leg. Kitchikov edges forward. Bulgarian, can he maintain control of center cage? No. Mahalbin backs him up, shoots in for another double leg takedown. Posts up on the left arm as Kitchikov defends the takedown. Back to his feet.
Kitchikov stopping the takedowns pretty well. Once he gets that whizzer on top, he's able to stand back up. Now he's got the underhook on the right side. A little bit of jockeying for position here. Nice elbow over the top by Mahalbin.
Mahalbin did predict that he would knock out Kitchikov with punches here tonight. Kitchikov said, I don't mind going to the judges. I've just got to show them more. I've got to tick off that checklist. Cage control, takedown defense, aggression. Certainly, he's shown quite a bit of each so far, Mitch.
He's definitely got the takedown defense, but you can see that Mahalbin is starting to land these takedowns, but he's also telegraphing them as well. The first round, you can see that Mahalbin's takedowns were effective, but Kitchikov might have a read on exactly what he needs to do to stop it. But Mahalbin needs to set that takedown up a little bit better. Throw the hands, then dive down.
Does Kitchikov need to pick up the aggression here, Mitch? Is Mahalbin initiating more offense than the Bulgarian?
He is. I mean, there's a little bit just in the takedown area. Nobody's really landing a lot of strikes. There's no striking superiority shown by either guys. Just as I say that, Kitchikov lands a right hand that lands pretty well. But we're just not seeing the activity we're going to see because these takedowns might start accumulating on the judges' scorecards. And will it be enough to, I mean, will his defense, you know, negate the takedowns? Right here, this is going to tell us a lot. What do we see here? Good defense, but he's able to stick it. And he secures it. Look at the way he's lacing that leg. So Kitchikov can't slide it out, pop back up.
Solid work here from Mahalbin. You saw him throw a nice little popping knee before. Back up onto their feet here, backed against the cage, the Bulgarian. Chance for the elbows, Mahalbin couldn't get him off. Threads it overhand right. Looks to transition to a takedown. Couldn't get it, throws it into the ribs. Roundhouse kick. Kitchikov's got to get off the cage here. Mahalbin methodical with the striking now. Throws the knee. Kitchikov in trouble. Mahalbin hammers away. Kitchikov locking onto that ankle. For preservation, under a minute to go.
Shifted into an entirely different gear, putting it on Kitchikov, landing a variety of strikes, punches, knees, kicks, really demonstrating some superior striking. Now he's on top, landing the ground and pound. But what kind of heart Kitchikov got? He's still hanging in there.
Big left hand to end the round there from Mahalbin. Yuji Shimada gets us underway. Mahalbin touches gloves. He opens as a southpaw. Seen him switch and switch constantly in every round. In fact, Mahalbin spent most of the second round in orthodox style. You see a little bit more gusto, a little bit more mustard and pepper behind the punches now of Kitchikov.
Kitchikov's got to shift things up a little bit. He's behind on Brandon Vera's scorecard. He's got to let things go. He's going to need near finish or KO to get this match.
He's got to tick off that aggression, Mitch.
And he's just not behind it. You can see that Mahalbin unleashed that aggression in the last 2 minutes of the second round. But we judge matches on their entirety, not round by round. So Kitchikov has still got a shot.
Kitchikov comes forward, tries for a 3-2. Left hook, straight right, cross combination. 3-2 again from the Bulgarian. Now bringing the hands into play here in the third and final. Oh, he telegraphed that one, didn't Mahalbin. Straight right cross out of orthodox stance. Outside leg kick. Haven't seen too many of them from the Chinese martial artist. Outside leg kick again.
I think Mahalbin kind of spent a lot of energy in the last 2 minutes of that second round. He just doesn't seem to be as fresh as he was in the second. Now Kitchikov is starting to put it on him.
And Mahalbin's hands are lowered a little. His guard's a little more open. There are openings here. There are opportunities for Kitchikov, who is unloading with his hands.
You can see him starting to drop that left hand. Mahalbin's left hand is coming down. And Satir's throwing that overhand right.
And he find the hole here, Kitchikov. Can he thread that right hand when Mahalbin drops the left? Especially when Mahalbin is in orthodox stance and leaves that jaw exposed. It is taggable. Fake there from Kitchikov. Nice high check from the Bulgarian. Much better round so far from Kitchikov.
He's definitely doing it, but is he doing enough, Michael? Is he putting up aggression and volume? Is he showing the striking superiority? I don't know. Mahalbin's right there throwing that right hand. Got the clinch now.
Boy, tight clinch and knees from Mahalbin. Kitchikov looking for a takedown. Wants to put the wrestler on his back. Every wrestler doesn't want to be. Now Kitchikov, side control. Best position he's been in the match so far.
Very true. That's surprising. Almost zero resistance coming from Mahalbin. But nice bridge there as he pops back up. Just as I say that. Flies out of side control. Good job, Mahalbin.
Flies because he's there. Something even, right?
Precisely. That was the plan that was intended.
Feet, 2 minutes to remain. He loads up on the right hand there. Does Mahalbin controlling center cage, backing up Kitchikov now. The Bulgarian snaps in the 1-2. Big overhand right from Mahalbin. Left hook from the Chinese athlete. Kitchikov's got to start coming forward. Cannot let the aggression get away from him now. Had some momentum about a minute and a half ago, but it seems to have disappeared from the Bulgarian.
You see the cage control of Mahalbin. He is dictating where this match takes place. He's the one pressing forward, initiating the takedowns. And as I say that, so dear Kitchikov lands a takedown of his own. Beautifully done. You can see Mahalbin has his back up against the wall. He's going to start to walk back up. Kitchikov trying to pull the hips away.
You feel that time is now the enemy of Satir Kitchikov. Mahalbin looking for a way back to his feet. Kitchikov wants to put the wrestler on his back.
He's got his hands clasped around that legs. Mahalbin, so it's really difficult. Now he triangles the legs. It's a bad spot for Mahalbin to be in. Wrestlers typically aren't used to being on their back like this.
Mitch, do you think it may be going through the mind of Mahalbin that he thinks he's done enough that he's won this contest?
I hope not, because you never know. I don't think he's probably thinking that. I think he's tired. That second round and the latter part of this, he's putting everything he has in each one of these shots.
That is something we've never seen from this youngster. We've never seen Mahalbin tired here at one championship.
Very true, but he often gets it done pretty quick, you know? So we're seeing a new dimension for him, and we're also seeing that resilience at such a young age. He's only 23 years old.
But he's still in the final 20 seconds, gets a quite easy takedown of Kichikov, which doesn't all go well for the Bulgarian. So ground and pound now from the Southern Eagle to round out this contest. He'll take the back one last time of the Bulgarian. Goes to side control, drops the elbows, and we are going down to the judges.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of battle, we turn now to the judges' scorecards. All three judges have scored this bout in favor of your winner by unanimous decision from the blue corner, Ma Hao Bi.
Ready, go!
Wherever you're watching, in over 128 countries worldwide, we hope you're enjoying the home of martial arts. Kelly in the white, Nunes in the black. Both men in orthodox starts, huge height and reach differential in favor of Nunes. Look for Nunes to go for the liver shot. Drop the left hand to the right side of the body around the floating ribs, the 9th and 10th ribs. Try and impact that vagus nerve. Try and put the body into shutdown mode.
Eric Kelly threw that rear leg push kick right to the face of Nunes. That's one of his favorite weapons. Connects. Shut his eye just for a minute.
Muay Thai champion, Rafael Nunes. We've already seen many contenders for the Go Daddy knockout of the night so far. Could we get another one here?
Anticipation is building.
Chance go up for Kelly inside the ball of Asia Arena. Threats a right-handers Nunes. Kelly drifts back to center cage. Just feel this one could turn any second. So much intensity, so much intrigue about this match all throughout the last month, Mitch.
Nunes looks to be loading up with that right hand. He's got his elbow flared out, ready to drop it. Lots of mutual respect shown right here. Nobody wants to make a mistake at this point in the match.
You see, Kelly does not want to give up center cage. He fakes a right hand. Nunes edging, inching forward every second. Tries to back him up with a jab. The long arms on the Brazilian. Wild bolo punch almost there from Kelly.
Like to see Kelly set that up a little bit. Throw out that jab. See if he can just gauge the distance. He's throwing those big right hands.
Nunes. Got to be careful not to circle into the right hand of Kelly. Kelly throws a roundhouse kick. No switch up off the lead leg. Threads a jab again, does Rafael Nunes.
You can see the height advantage of Nunes. He's a full 10 centimeters taller than Eric Kelly. But he hasn't really utilized that reach yet.
This crowd, no doubt, inspiring Eric Kelly. Maybe the Brazilians tonight inspired by the fact that Renzo Gracie is one of our luminaries here cage side. Always makes you want to compete that little bit harder, Mitch.
I know the feeling of having Renzo in the crowd.
Snappy jab, there's the right hand for company from Eric Kelly, the natural. 2 minutes remaining in the first round. Very much a dip your toes in the water first round. Both men with a feeling, a process, seeing what the other has to offer.
And they're doing that with just these one, two shots, lots of respect shown. As Nunes tried to duck under, Kelly pushing Nunes back with that push kick.
Wasn't quite sure what he wanted there. Kelly may have thought about a right hand, decided on a front kick, and it was only half-hearted. Nunes back to center cage. Kelly backs him up with a solid right hand. There's the jab from the Brazilian. Fakes the jab, throws a right hand lead, does Nunes. They've used a lot of the center cage here. Haven't really gone to the perimeters, Mitch.
They've just been standing toe-to-toe, just testing each other out, feeling each other. Big, big swings by Kelly. He attacks the leg there.
And a thumping outside thigh kick to that common peroneal nerve just above the lead knee of Rafael Nunes.
Like the change-up throw. Throw some punches, throw in a leg kick, get Nunes thinking about something, maybe attempt a takedown.
Nunes has the reach. Haven't seen him go for the body shots, though. Gets a driving takedown. Will look to pass guard here. Go to side control, the Brazilian. What's Kelly seeking to do here, Mitch?
Kelly was trying to keep him in half guard, but Nunes was just able to step over. Now he's looking for an arm. And see, he's got mount, but Kelly's scrambling out with the leg. Now he's giving up his back. Nunes is going to have about 30 seconds to work here.
Take the back of Eric Kelly, no can do. Kelly surviving, 20 seconds remains, first round.
Nunes does have 5 submission wins, all by choke, so he likes to go after the neck. Here he's going for the arm.
Arm by attack from Nunes. He's been competing with BJJ over the last 3 years, but he won't find a sub in the final seconds. And we're going to go into the second round of action. Kelly starts to fire off some of his wushu prowess.
You can see a small mouse developing under the eye of Eric Kelly, and that's from that big right hand that Nunes landed in the first round, at the beginning of the first round.
Nunes high on the balls of his feet here. Used the jab well in the opening round. Front kick, catches the kick, takedown there from Nunes, tried for some ground and pound, up kicks from Eric Kelly. Nunes trying to pass guard, will he allow Kelly back to his feet? Tries to scoop those legs to the side, go to side control, Kelly won't let him get there.
Beautifully done, good feet placement on the hips to really control where Nunes is actually being positioned. He's trying to posture up, now he's going to pass into side control. Eric Kelly, that knee, he's got to stay there, he's got to keep moving. Nice pass by Rafael Nunes. Now he's in side control.
Mitch, tell us the options for Nunes from side control.
Nunes got a lot of options right here. He can A, put the knee on belly, slide into mount, and go after ground and pound and choking. Or he can step over the head, what he's doing, and threaten a possible inverted triangle. Or he can attack that right arm of Kelly and go after some shoulder locks. But he's also got a darce choke right there. He's got that deep. He's going to try to lace the leg of Eric Kelly so he can get it deep into an anaconda. Eric Kelly's got to avoid those legs.
Oh, he's out! Thank your mother for the ribbons. He's tipped him out of the second round. Well, how about that? Turning like a dial, Rafael Nunes tapped out Eric Kelly. And you can hear tumbleweeds blowing through the ball of Asia Arena. I don't think anyone saw that coming that quickly.
Yeah, he had a few options there inside. Once Eric Kelly threw the push kick, once too many times, Rafael Nunes was able to catch the push kick, get the match to the ground. Beautiful pass here. Look at this. Eric Kelly elevates him. Rafael Nunes stays with it, passes the guard, gets passed, drops a little ground and pound. Here he sinks in. Could be an anaconda right there, nice and tight. Instead of going to the legs, he was so tight. He had such a good squeeze.
The Philippines, Joshua Pacio.
Pacio says he wants to test the stand-up of the Sanda champion. He wants to utilize that push kick and his big 1-2 combination to really see what the defense like is of Lan Ming Qiang.
Lan Ming Qiang wants to keep the contest on the feet. Pacio will test the striking, look for the takedown, and hope to sub him with a rear naked or a guillotine. Lan Ming Qiang did say, I'll knock him out in one round. It was a bold prediction from the Chinese martial artist who lands an inside thigh kick. Pacio has got to have his defenses on the money. So too is counter-striking here, Mitch.
He's trying to time it, catches the low kick, transitions into a nice body clinch. It's a bad spot for Lan Ming Qiang to be in. He's got to create a little bit of movement. He throws his leg up, crosses it over his own leg, and that kind of prevents Joshua Pacio from sliding the knee onto his belly.
Let's see how Lan Ming Qiang handles the ground. Off his back here, the Chinese cuts the hip into Pacio, drops the elbows to the ear of the Chinese martial artist. Here come the knees to the rib cage.
This is what we thought was going to be the difference maker in this match, is the grappling of Joshua Pacio. typically with Sanda artists, you see them throw somebody and then they back off because that was a point scored. They don't typically stay on the ground. But with Joshua Pacio, he has a well-rounded ground game. Now he's on top, dropping a little bit of the elbows, trying to soften him up. Ooh, he steps over in the mouth. This is a bad spot for Lan Ming Qiang.
Great fight for the legs, and he did so easily there, Joshua Pacio. What a ground display so far from Pacio.
Lan Ming Qiang's got to let go of that body lock he's got. He's got to create a little bit of space. You can see the hips of Joshua Pacio are pressing down. That's kind of neutralizing Lan Ming Qiang from moving away.
Round and pound here, still from the mount position from Joshua Pacio. Pacio's up now. There's the elbow. Turns the knuckles in off the right hand. Here are the elbows off the left from Pacio.
Elbows, punches coming down. Now he's attacking the body. Lan Ming Qiang's trying to bridge out, but he's got to let go of the body lock on Pacio.
Big elbow again from Joshua Pacio. Just past the halfway point of the opening round, and it's dominance here from the young Filipino.
Good hip pressure. He's got his legs sprawled out. He's pressing down on his hips. See that hip pressure? Lan Ming Qiang can't go anywhere. Now he's looking for possibly an arm triangle, but he's got to give up mount and go over to the other side.
Is it going to happen for Joshua Pacio? Can he find the finish on Lan Ming Qiang?
It's a tough spot to finish. He's got to get over onto the side. The arm triangle, he chooses to let it go.
And Lan Ming Qiang survives. And Pacio, it's all one-way traffic. Still in the full mount. How does Lan Ming Qiang get out of this match?
He's got to push off the hips and start bumping and elevate the hips of Joshua Pacio and then slide his hips out. He's got a bad spot, but he's choosing to defend the strikes. If you're in that spot, you know you're going to get hit. He's got a great scramble. He's
trying to move. For the ground and pound. Triangle. Tries to slap on the choke again. This crowd is deafening for Joshua Pacio. Can he find the finish?
Oh, as Lan Ming Qiang pushes up one arm, Joshua Pacio.
Yes, he's done it. He said rear naked choke. He scored rear naked choke. Joshua Pacio.
Beautifully done, Michael. Had one arm. When Lan Ming Qiang defended against the other, he slid the other arm in across the neck, secured the choke, and applied the squeeze. Here's the takedown. Joshua Pacio has the double unders, takes him down, ends up in side control, transitions into mount, drops a little bit of ground and pound, but then gets the back and finishes with the rear naked choke.
Emphatic victory for Joshua Pacio. Brandon Vera Pacio is a young man going places in a hurry.
Chalk.
Let's see if Eustaquio can get off the wushu strikes early. Maybe look for a GoDaddy knockout of the night. And will Akhmetov look to take him down and put Eustaquio on his back? Akhmetov surprised us last time. Striking in the opening round with high roundhouse kicks and outside crescent kicks. At the moment, just seeing what Eustaquio has to offer. Getting a feel of things. And also the feel of this heavily partisan audience all behind Geje Eustaquio here in Manila.
Geje looks really relaxed. I like how he's occasionally dropping his hands because that's going to enable him to defend the takedown even better. He said earlier that he's not scared of the striking of Kairat Akhmetov. He needs to worry about the takedown. And by having his guard nice and low, he's going to be able to dig under the underhooks of Kairat Akhmetov or push the head down.
Akhmetov's been training at Tiger Muay Thai in Phuket alongside some of the best Muay Thai stylists on the planet to hone his striking skills. Let's see if they come to the fore here in the opening round. Fake there from Akhmetov. Nice cutting side kick to the lead thigh from Eustaquio. Fake from Akhmetov in southpaw stance here, the Kazakh in the white trunks. Edges forward, flicks up a can't really call it a front kick. It was more of a pump kick there from the Kazakh.
Look at the movement of Eustaquio. He saw that coming and he just glided out of the way. It's like he slows down time. Pay attention to the head movement of Geje Eustaquio. It is so beautiful.
Really does get into the matrix sometimes. Geje Eustaquio, invasive here in the opening round. Wushu stylist looking confident so far, Mitch.
I'd like to see him counter off of that movement. Get out of the way, make him miss, but he's got to make him pay.
Side kick again to the lead thigh from Geje. Roundhouse kick. Akhmetov tried to catch him. Drags him to the canvas. Looks to take the back.
Beautifully done. He gets the body lock, slides around to the back. Now he's working on the back control. He's going to try to slide his feet in underneath, capture inside the hooks. He's got one hook in, but he's got also hip control here. He can still finish from this position without having both hooks in.
Eustaquio defending as Akhmetov will slowly try and work his way to a rear naked choke here. But not if Geje has something to say about it. Eustaquio almost out of trouble. Gives his back again. And Akhmetov tries to sink the choke. Eustaquio back to his feet.
Geje's scrambling well, but this is the cage control that I was talking about with Kairat Akhmetov. He dictates where this is taking place. Look at that body lock, nice and tight. And Geje's got good scrambling, but he's not able to get away because of that control that Akhmetov has.
You are seeing the skills of one of the finest Greco-Roman wrestlers on the planet in Kairat Akhmetov. It's not Eustaquio's world down here. Geje wants to get it back to the feet, back to a standing position.
It's timing for a leg lock, though. He's going after it.
What a shot that would be!
Ibar.
If he could sub out Akhmetov, it would really bring the house down! Could he do it? It would be crazy!
Akhmetov is defending well, but he's got to be a little bit deeper. Geje's got to pull the leg in. There's a heel hook here. Akhmetov has underhooks now. This is a good position. He can use this to bump out.
Not where a Greco-Roman wrestler wants to be on their back, Mitch.
He does definitely. He's not used to train on his back, but Kairat Akhmetov is a seasoned grappler. He's very experienced in Brazilian jiu-jitsu, and he's going after the neck right now. Geje's trying to pass the half guard.
Nice elbow just postured up momentarily for Geje, trying to open up the legs of Kairat so he can pass to side control on the left side of the Kazakh. But you see Akhmetov locking down that left leg of Eustaquio.
He's trying to move, he's more just trying to control the posture. I don't think he wants Geje to posture up and start dropping the elbows in. So he's keeping his head nice and tight, and he's managing to survive out this round.
Elbows here from Geje Eustaquio to end the round. The ground and pound, superbly done.
Round two.
Second round set for five. Interim world title on the line. Geje Eustaquio in the red. Kairat Akhmetov in the white. His one championship. Global Superheroes live from Manila, broadcast to over 128 countries. We hope you're enjoying it. Eustaquio hasn't had a submission win since 2012. I know he'd love to get one back on his resume. Akhmetov looking very relaxed, very loose in the stand-up. Good inside leg kick. Swept out that lead leg of Eustaquio. Gut-munching knee there from Eustaquio. Akhmetov presses him back against the cage. They break off. Inside leg kick from Eustaquio. High on the thigh. Goes to the bread basket with the right hand. Mitch, what similarities, what differences are you seeing from this to the first encounter?
Well, now we're starting to see a shift in the tide. You can see that Geje Eustaquio is starting to control the superiority in both the ground, like Brandon Vera said, but also right now in the stand-up. If he can keep it here and really adjust his timing and his strategy, we can really start to see Geje Eustaquio take advantage or take control of this match.
We're definitely not seeing the comfort in the stand-up or the volume from Akhmetov as we did in the previous match.
He definitely had a certain sense of swagger about him, didn't he, Michael, in those first three rounds. But now as we're in round five between these two high-level martial artists, we can see the way that Geje Eustaquio is starting to cut the angles, position Akhmetov up against the cage and start to unload some of these strikes. You gotta wonder, when is the double leg from Akhmetov gonna come into play?
Akhmetov in southpaw starts. Geje Eustaquio wants to engage that right hand down the center corridor. Public enemy number one of the southpaw is the straight right hand. Akhmetov edging forward. Geje looks to have that right hand cocked and ready and just throws down Akhmetov. Inside knee kick nicely placed from Eustaquio. There's the right hand down the tube. There's the lead hand to the breadbasket. Certainly not seeing Akhmetov with the striking he had last time out. Ill-timed leg kick. Nice parry of the kick there from Eustaquio. What tactic do you see here from Akhmetov, Mitch?
He's trying to land strikes. He's trying to go after straight hands, but he just landed a beautiful straight left hand there. He's trying to push forward, but Jay is so evasive in his defense. He's gliding and sliding out of the way and then countering now. He's getting more and more comfortable in there. Akhmetov's got to change things up. He's got to put Geje down on the mat and grind on him. That's what he's best at.
No attempts at a double leg and a body clinch. Any sort of takedown from Akhmetov here in the second round. We are seeing a glorified kickboxing contest between these two martial artists. A looping punch, then went for a double leg attempt with Akhmetov, but to no avail.
But you can see the low hands of Eustaquio is able for him to get these underhooks and keep Akhmetov away from attacking the legs. Now he's got him up in the upper body clinch. If he wins this, he can get away. This is a huge confidence booster for him, and he does just that.
That knee from Eustaquio almost folded him in half like origami. A big pickup, but didn't get the put down he wanted. Akhmetov still trying to find a way to get Eustaquio down, and now he may have it, Mitch.
That was a beautiful double leg takedown. He slid under the punches of Eustaquio, and now he's on his back. Eustaquio should let him up.
Eustaquio tried to catch him with the right hand on the way up. Momentum now with the Filipino. Eustaquio smack bang on the kisser with the right, then goes to the inside leg.
I like how he's attacking that inside leg. He should beat that leg up constantly, attacking that leg. Slow down Kairat so it's a stationary target. He's not threatening the double leg.
That right hand lead punch confounding Kairat Akhmetov. Akhmetov loads up a left, that being the power hand of the southpaw.
Geje can't let Akhmetov get him up against the cage. Akhmetov likes to punch into the double leg. Jehe's got to move around, get away from the cage, get his back away. That's it. Press him up against the cage now and circle out.
Good elbow and a break off there from Eustaquio. Final 10 seconds of the second round. Confident round for Geje Eustaquio. And now he's side kick to the knee. A little showboating. The bell sounds and we go to the taps.
Got to get it down. Plain and simple, he has to get this match to the ground, get Geje out of his comfort zone, and get to where he does his best work, and that's on time.
Are you surprised, Mitch, with all the time that Akhmetov has spent at Tiger Muay Thai since the last encounter, that he's striking does not seem to be as it was last time out? It's lessened.
It's not necessarily lessened. I just think he's having a hard time finding his rhythm because Geje is he's countering so well. He's moving, he's evading these shots. So Kairat's not able to establish his own rhythm and timing. He has to settle back down, find that, throw out those easy jabs, build his confidence, start connecting on some shots, maybe mix in some leg kicks, but he has to establish that rhythm that is so important for a striker to find, that confidence that you can hit your opponent.
Eustaquio taking his time, not rushing, not overextending himself. plenty of instruction coming from the corner of Kairat Akhmetov, right near our commentary position. No sense of desperation in that corner yet. Third of five. Inside leg kick there from Akhmetov. Body shot. Counter that took an agonizingly close for the Kazakh. Eustaquio tries to throw that hook. There's the outside thigh kick. There's the right hand. There's the outside thigh kick. Combination work now from the Filipino.
Beautifully done. Leg kick, straight right hand. Back to the leg kick. The striking superiority is mounting up with every exchange. But look, as Kairat threw that big right hand, Geje wasn't anywhere near it. So the frustration has got to be extremely evident all over Akhmetov because he's not able to connect. He's not able to touch him. Look at that. Blue slides right out of the way.
Invasive. Great footwork, the hallmarks of Eustaquio so far in this contest. A confidence oozing, that almost Mona Lisa half smile from Geje Eustaquio, enjoying himself in there, knowing that maybe at the moment he's got the upper hand on Kairat Akhmetov, maybe knowing he's inside the Kazakh's head.
Every single takedown, Geje is able to stop, his confidence levels up. We're seeing a whole different Geje Eustaquio. The striking is starting to flow. Look at that, slides out of the single leg attempt. Kairat's got to pressure up against the cage.
High knee from Eustaquio. Crowd oohs and ahs and gnashing of teeth every time he comes so close.
But look at that, Geje is able to turn Kairat around and press Kairat up against the cage, push away like it was nothing. That's huge, Michael.
We are seeing an exquisite round so far from Geje Eustaquio. The Filipino doing everything right. Is there some frustration creeping in on Kairat Akhmetov now? The Kazakh resets, but we haven't seen him with the aggression. We haven't seen him with the cage control in this round.
Geje Eustaquio has never been into the championship rounds. Kairat Akhmetov lives in the fourth and fifth round. He excels in those rounds. But we're seeing the confidence of Eustaquio just shine through. We're seeing the best gravity we have ever seen in one championship.
Is there any sign here, Mitch, of a deep water strategy from Akhmetov deliberately?
Man, it's hard to drag the Baguio City fighter or athletes into deep water. They train at altitude. Their conditioning is their best trait. These guys got gas tanks that are the size of semi-trucks. They know how to put in work, and conditioning is almost never a factor for them.
Jab there from Eustaquio. Eustaquio using his angles, and once again, the evasion. He is in the matrix tonight with his defense against the strikes of Akhmetov. Anything in this choke image?
It might be there, but Geje doesn't seem too concerned with it. He looks okay. Kairat's got a good squeeze. He's finished with chokes before.
Look at the bicep bulging, the deltoids also a little Kairat Akhmetov. Such a powerful Kazakh. Eustaquio surviving. Olivier Cost right on top of the action.
Kairat's got 10 wins by choke, so he's definitely very comfortable going after the neck. But look at Geje pressing Kairat up against the cage.
10 seconds remaining. Eustaquio surviving the choke attempt here from Kairat Akhmetov. And we're getting into the fourth round.
Round four, choke.
You gotta wonder, has Geje done enough in the first three rounds? Can Kairat come back from this hole? According to Brandon Vera's scorecard, Geje's light years ahead of Akhmetov. This is going to be very important. Akhmetov's trying to pressure him up against the cage. Is he going to shoot him for a takedown?
All it will take to turn the tide, to swing the pendulum, is for Akhmetov to body clinch or shoot him for a double leg and put Eustaquio on his back. But it hasn't happened yet. He's got to get Eustaquio on the ground.
But now he's got him pressed up against the cage, but he's not shooting for the double. Geje's good to get his back off the cage. He can't get pressed up against the cage like this.
In the first encounter, we saw these inventive outside crescent kicks and head kicks from Akhmetov. They're not apparent tonight.
He just doesn't have the same sort of confidence that he had in the first one to throw those, because Geje has been able to stop all of his takedowns, not take a lot of damage, and land strike after strike.
Dead center of the cage. Southpaw versus Orthodox. Let's see the right hand from Geje. He throws it. Akhmetov backs him against the fence.
See if Geje can spin him around again. He's got the body lock.
Called it.
Just that.
What does that say for the condition of Akhmetov at the moment that Geje can spin him around so easily?
It's the strength factor. Geje is typically, you know, more of a finesse guy. He's able to improve so much in strength and conditioning that he's able to out-grapple the Kazakh up against the cage.
And he landed a beautiful Muay Thai elbow to the hairline of Akhmetov just moments ago. Akhmetov trying for a two-punch combination of his own. But Eustaquio, you feel, is in the groove, in the moment, seeing what's coming from the Kazakh and responding. He turns him again, throws an elbow, breaks off everything right from Geje Eustaquio.
We are seeing a whole different game. The takedown defense has been the key to this match. He's able to stop the takedown, but also in the clinch as well. He's controlling Kairat up against the cage.
A six-week camp for Geje Eustaquio. Said last time out, I let Kairat dictate the match too much. I'm not gonna do it tonight. I'm gonna dictate the pace. I'm gonna dictate where it goes. I'm gonna apply the pressure. And indeed, he is living up to his word so far.
There has to be some desperation coming from the corner of Akhmetov. He has to start increasing the speed at which he's throwing these shots. He's got to let things go, because we're getting real close to the end of the fourth round here. There's one of those kicks we were talking about, though, Michael.
Finally, maybe the inventiveness of the striking coming back into play for Akhmetov. Now he's getting the legs up on Eustaquio. Eustaquio's little shimmies, his little pivots, his quarter angle turns. They've been superb. They've been sublime for the Filipino tonight. Here's the jab again. That roaring, roving jab to set the right hand. There's another side kick off the lead leg. A wushu favorite. Roundhouse kick to the forearm. Side kick to the thigh again.
The legs really well, and maybe that's factoring into a lot of these takedown attempts. Kairat might just not have the strength or the support in that lead leg.
Two-punch combination. Should have gone for four or six there, you feel, Kairat Akhmetov. Southpaw edging forward. Eustaquio resets. Eustaquio going clockwise into the lead hand of Akhmetov, which is where he wants to go against the left-handed athlete.
1 minute left in the fourth round.
Wild looping punch from Akhmetov. Tries to transition to a double leg. Crowd momentarily thought Eustaquio had a choke attempt.
Kairat has been the distance twice. He has been the full five rounds with the champion, Adriano Moraes. But now, have we seen Geje Eustaquio in these championship rounds? The answer is no. This is a new territory for him. Where he's tried to get the entire match. What can he do to Eustaquio in this position? He's running out of time, 10 seconds, and they're gonna get back up around five.
He finally gets Eustaquio on his back, but we've not enough time. And we're gonna go into the fifth and final round. It's gonna be electrifying.
Ready?
5 minutes remaining. This massive crowd behind Geje Eustaquio. What has Akhmetov got left? What tricks does the Kazakh warrior possess? And will we see Eustaquio employ the right hand? He said he'd knock out Akhmetov with the straight right. And it's Akhmetov who launches the heavy artillery early. Side kick, it's worth a treat for Eustaquio all night. outside leg kick. Good left hand, just needed a little bit more mustard behind it to Akhmetov.
Geje felt that, he rattled his head back. That one landed cleanly. I wish you could see him follow up with that. Throw a leg kick behind that big left hand he's throwing.
Body shot from Geje Eustaquio. Now he'd love to have the gold here in the Philippines and set up a showdown with Adriano Moraes. Fake there from Akhmetov. Akhmetov does have punching power. One big salvo could turn the tide here.
You can see that Kairat is starting to land shots. He's starting to, you know, pick things up a little bit. Maybe that, the, you know, the final round, is he sensing that urgency?
Well, like we said, Mitch, could it be a deep water strategy all along from Kairat Akhmetov? He's looking the best of the striking now that he has throughout the entire contest.
Very true. Geje slowing down a bit. This is Kairat's chance to really put it on. Geje.
Tough shot there to the sternum from Geje Eustaquio. And Akhmetov fires back. A lot of speed, a lot of power in that overhand left.
Geje stepped on the foot the same time that he threw that punch, causing Kairat to lose balance. I like the strategy.
Center of the cage, neither man willing to give it up. Right hand lead, outside thigh kick, clever combination from Eustaquio.
I like the way he punctuates each combination by throwing that leg kick.
Threads the right hand between the double forearms, jab to right, the old 1-2 kangaroo. Body shot there from Akhmetov. Curl and left hook over the top from the Filipino. He's answering everything now. Starting to sense that they are 2 minutes and 20 away from a Filipino interim world champion. Jab two from Eustaquio. The corner of Akhmetov, but it's out there, man, to go, to pull out all the stops, to throw caution to the wind. Beautiful evasion from Eustaquio, lands in there. This is a treat to watch. Geje Eustaquio at the height of his martial arts powers, Mitch.
Good combination by Kairat to come in there with that straight left, put a hook behind it, but he's got to increase. He's got to go for the finish. He's got to go for broke in the last 1 minute and 40 seconds of round five.
Checks the inside thigh kick to Eustaquio. Staring down the barrel into the eyes of Kairat Akhmetov. He's beaten him physically so far, we feel. Also, perhaps psychologically tonight. Time is ticking down for Akhmetov. 1:15 remains. Again, this crowd starting to bubble, starting to simmer. They're feeling it. They know their man is in sight of the gold. Minute remaining now. Akhmetov's got to pull out the stops. He cannot hold back any longer. Eustaquio dancing. Wrench the overhand right. There's a counter shot from Akhmetov. And again, no mustard from the Kazakh. 35 seconds now. Eustaquio's confidence oozing out of every pore of his body. 25 seconds for Akhmetov to find something. There's the left hook. It's going to require a Hail Mary shot now from the Kazakh. He picks him up. He drives him down. But what can he find in 10 seconds? He's going to find a submission, but he's not going to get there. Eustaquio takes some elbows for his trouble, but he's going to see out the round.
Scorecards. All three judges have scored this contest in favor of your winner by unanimous decision. And now the one interim Flyweight World Champion!